further ado, I would like to welcome the next speaker, Mirko Freier from TU Dortmund. Please start, and we're looking forward to your talk.
Thank you very much. I, of course, also want to thank the organizers for bringing me here. It's always nice to boil hot here, coming from Germany. And I appreciate that you are all here because I understand that this is the hardest time of the day, right after lunch. I would also like to take a nap. So I'm from Dortmund, that's true, but I have also a part-time affiliation at the Offa Institute in St. Petersburg, and this is not totally unimportant for this particular talk. So the title is Giant Interactions of Rydberg Excitons. I want to acknowledge my co-workers. These are actually, how was it called, Russian Mafia from St. Petersburg, and the rest is German Mafia. We have some collaboration with the group of Günter Wunner in Stuttgart, some collaboration with the group of Stefan Scheel in Rostock. Thomas Pohl from Aarhus is collaborating with us. Okay, Danish Mafia. And recently also some collaboration with Harald Giesen from Stuttgart. So this is the outline of my talk. Since I'm the first one talking about excitons, I thought I'd make a short introduction what excitons are, because not everybody, in particular the people from atomic physics, might not know this exactly. Then I will turn to these Rydberg excitons in cuprous oxide. And afterwards, in fact, when we started this work, we wanted to move very quickly from this part to this part, study interactions, because we were sort of inspired by atomic people. Then we got basically trapped for 2 years in semiconductor-specific questions, because before you study interaction in the effects, you should, of course, understand the features of the individual excitons. And I want to highlight some crystal-specific features which one just needs to take into account and which makes our life, I believe, in the meantime, sort of more difficult than in atomic physics. But I won't discuss this in detail. We did a lot of studies in electric field and magnetic field just to give some short points here or highlight some points. And finally, turn to these Rydberg exciton interactions and our present understanding far away from atomic case. Okay, excitons. What is an exciton? We are talking here about semiconductors, intrinsic semiconductors. So ideally, our semiconductor is not doped. You will see that all semiconductors have some unintentional doping which cause free carriers in this material, and this is unavoidable no matter how clean your crystal is. And the role of this unintentional doping is still sort of unclear in our case. But for the moment, we suppose that we have an ideal 3D semiconductor, bulk semiconductor, which turned out to be correct. If you talk about excitons, you might think about the prototype semiconductor for optical properties, and this is gallium arsenide. And in gallium arsenide, you can, of course, apply this binding energy formula, but your Rydberg energy is only 4.2 millielectron volt, so really small, 1,000 times smaller than for atoms. And if you look then for the absorption spectrum due to excitons, you find this result. The band gap energy here is at zero energy. And if you take Kittel seriously and you read Kittel solid state physics and you read the chapter on optical properties of direct band gap semiconductors, it tells you that the absorption should follow basically the joint density of states, which for a 3D system of electrons and holes, which for a 3D system should follow a square root of energy like dependence. This is what we teach our students, but it was never observed because exciton effects are not taken into account. And what the exciton does is it leads to these bound states below the energy gap, below the fundamental energy gap. The binding energies indeed follow roughly this formula, but it also modifies the absorption strongly above the band gap by shuffling exciton oscillator strength from higher energies towards the band gap, so you never observe for a direct band gap semiconductor the square root dependence, but it's always step-like. And this is the best absorption spectrum that you can find in literature for gallium arsenide. It's nice because it was also recorded in Dortmund. And here you see clearly this would be the result when you take Kittel seriously, and this is actually what you observe. You indeed see that there is a step-like dependence. And even more important, below the band gap, you see these sharp features, which are the excitons. But this is the best semiconductor, so to speak, and you see that you find three bound states. n equals 1, n equals 2, n equals 3. 3 is almost already coinciding with the band gap here, but since we see three states and their binding energy roughly follow this formula, we say an exciton is a hydrogen-like particle. Yeah. But you see also, and I want to highlight this, that this is a very clean crystal, but still you have these features here, which I don't want to discuss in detail. They are denoted here BEC, which means bound exciton complex, not Bose-Einstein condensation, but bound exciton complex, which just means that this is a very clean crystal, but no matter how clean you prepare your crystal, you always have some rubbish inside, yeah? And these defects basically trap excitons and lead to emission which is shifted from the pure exciton emission. And this is true for all crystals, also for our crystals. Actually, the exciton was not discovered. This is also a funny story because this spectrum was then reproduced in a textbook by Mark Fox on optical properties of solids. And there you see that suddenly, this is just a reproduction by hand, suddenly all the rubbish has disappeared. And it looks like you have a perfect crystal. Yeah, I sent him an email, he never replied. Okay, the excitons actually were not discovered in gallium arsenide, but in cuprous oxide. And the reason was also at the Joffe Institute, by the way, by Evgeny Gross in 1952, so 21 years or so after the theoretical proposal. This was the first observation. And the reason why they were observed in cuprous oxide and not in gallium arsenide is the simple fact that the ripback energy is here roughly 100 milli-electron volt, so 20 times larger. So they are much more stable in this material. Actually, this was also the material from which the first semiconductor devices were fabricated, because you can get this material in rather high quality in nature. And so the first rectifiers, for example, were fabricated from cuprous oxide. But as soon as silicon and germanium showed up and the material quality was improved for these materials, I mean, cuprous oxide was out. But as you see here, this is an absorption spectrum recorded at 1.3 Kelvin. And you see here the exciton series, n equals 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, with some imagination. You do not see n equals 1, and I will come back to this in a moment. This is a specific feature of this semiconductor. This is the original setup, of course. It's now no longer at the Joffe Institute, but it's at the university. They still use it for lab courses. So I also signed up there and performed the experiment. And just to show you, I mean, this was really great that they discovered this, because this is the spectral resolution that they had. This is just a white light source, and this is the spectral resolution that they have, but still they could resolve this exciton series, which is really great work, much more simple than our setups today. So the question that we were asking, and I have to give credit here to our Russian colleagues, because we wanted to stop studying cuprous oxide. We were hunting exciton Bose-Einstein condensation in this material, but unfortunately the condensation was always faster than we were, so we wanted to stop. But shortly before we stopped, our Russian colleagues told us, in order to honor Gross, could you record with your highly sophisticated stuff that you have in your lab, could you record one more an absorption spectrum and just look to what principal quantum number you can go in this hydrogen series. Okay, we did it. We did not believe that we would have any nice result, but still we did it. And I should point out that the materials that we are using, cuprous oxide crystals, are natural materials. So these are not artificial crystals, but these are crystals from the Tsumeb mine in Namibia, which still provides the best crystals. I will also come back to this point in a moment. We cut out small pieces from this crystal, polish them, mount them strain-free, and study them. We knew already 10 years ago that these crystals had very, very good quality. And I don't want to discuss the details of the 1s exciton. It's a totally forbidden exciton, at least the para exciton down here. But you can sort of make it optically active by applying a magnetic field. It's like an underlying odd one, and you make it optically active in a quadrupolar transition. But these are details which are not important for the rest of the talk. Just to point out, we had then one of these fancy single frequency lasers. For semiconductor people, these are fancy because you typically do not need this high resolution that they provide. But still, we had one, so we used it, and we scanned from lower energies to higher energies, and then you can come into resonance with this para-exciton, and you see this extremely sharp absorption line, which is has a line width of 84 nanoelectron volts, which for semiconductor people is very unusual. And it's also unusual because you observe this extremely narrow line in this natural crystal, which tells you that the natural crystal is not very inhomogeneous. Yeah, you can move also the spot across this crystal, and there are no big variations. So these are definitely high-quality materials. This is just a few details. What is cuprous oxide? It consists basically of a BCC lattice here formed by the oxygen atoms and the FCC lattice formed by the copper atoms. And they are shifted by a quarter of the diagonal of the unit cell. So this is a crystal. This is the band structure in simple terms. I will also come back to this. In very simply speaking, it's just a two-band semiconductor. You have here the conduction band, and you have the valence band, the topmost valence band, which is also a single band. Yeah, and they look roughly parabolic. They are not, but roughly they are parabolic. What is also important here, if you want to record absorption here in one photon transition, it's important that this valence band is mostly made up of d-like atomic orbitals, d-like atomic orbitals. So L equals 2, while the conduction band is mostly made up of S-like atomic orbitals, L equals 1, L equals 0. So you cannot make this transition here in single photon absorption. What helps you is if you involve the envelope wave function of the exciton, and if this envelope wave function of the exciton is a P-type wave function with L equals 1, you can sort of combine the angular momenta here so that you have optical, why it's extremely sharp here. Then you scan further up to higher energies, and here you see already the first complication. We are in a crystal lattice, and a crystal lattice just provides phonons. So exactly one LO phonon above the 1s exciton, you see that a very broad absorption starts here. And then when you approach this high energy part, you see a large number of discrete exciton absorption lines, which are the lines which we are interested, but I want to highlight here that they are sitting on this huge background of phonons, so you cannot easily suppress the phonon interaction. Of course, solid-state people develop now resonators for suppressing phonons and all that stuff, but this is still at its infancy. So we always have this strong phonon interaction, and actually for the lines that I'm going to discuss in a moment, we know by now that the line width is 90% made of phonon interaction, and only 10% is contributed by radiative decay. So you cannot avoid phonons. Okay, so this is then the picture from the original publication of lines here, in which, so you have to zoom into this high energy part, and what you actually find is that we can identify lines up to n equals 25. Then you might say, okay, this is ridiculous. Atomic physics people go to 500 or so. But the good thing which plays in our favor is that in our case, the Bohr radius is significantly larger just because of this dielectric screening. It's 1.1 nanometer. So when you just plug in n equals 25 here, L equals 1 for p-type excitons, you find that the extension of this 25 state is 1 micrometer. So this corresponds to an exciton wave function, which is really huge, and it covers roughly 10 billion crystal unit cells. I mean, this is what one always has to have in mind, that this is not two charges in vacuum, but this is really in a crystal, and we know exactly that within this coherence volume, for example, we have a lot of defects, and trillions of charges. Still, the exciton is stable. If you look now at this n equals 25 state, we were thinking for quite some time that we are limited to n equals 25 just because of thermal reasons. Yeah, if you calculate the binding energy of this state, this is Rydberg divided by 25 squared. The Rydberg energy is only roughly 100 millielectron volt. So if you calculate this 100 divided by 25 squared, the energy that you get is very much comparable to the thermal energy at 1.2 Kelvin. This is to what temperature we cooled the crystal because we used helium-4. So we were thinking, okay, if we go down, let's say, into the 50 millikelvin range or so, able to see N equal 100. So this is what we did, or Julian Heckhöder did, he sitting in the audience. We went down to 47 millikelvin. This is the lowest temperature that we could achieve. This is the spectrum that we could record. Here is N equals 25, the highest number that we could record so far. And we can go up maybe to N equals 28, but that's it. And we understand it by now through the influence of free carriers in the crystal, which in effect lower the band gap. So there is always an unavoidable plasma of free carriers around, which reduces the band gap. I will come back to this at the end, where we studied on purpose the influence of an electron hole plasma with excitons and worked out this influence more clearly. Okay, then the next question, what is so specific about these crystals? Natural crystals, we know exactly that there are artificial crystals prepared all over the world, which have a lower defect density than our crystals. So still we had also such artificial crystals, and they are just rubbish. Yeah, they are just a waste. And we spent quite some time to study these crystals. What is so specific about these crystals from Namibia, from this particular mine? So we have some collaboration. This is our best result in Dortmund. We had some collaboration with Harald Giesen, who, after he saw our results, bought crystals on eBay from every possible source that you can imagine. And this is the result. This is the Stuttgart Namibia crystal, up to N equals 16, Congo crystal N equals 13, but another Congo crystal N equals 18. And the conditions here were not ideal because these crystals were glued onto some glass, which induces some strain and produces the number of observable states. So the good message is these crystals don't have to come from Namibia, but still they have to be African. This is the current status. I don't want to exclude that maybe Siberian or whatever crystals could be similar good. But at the moment, I would say they have to be African crystals. Okay, then one can, of course, have a crude look at the hydrogen-like exciton series, and you see that the binding energy indeed rather well follows this N2-2 dependence. I will also come back to this in a moment. We see here the line width that we observe, and we start here in the millielectron volt range, and as we go higher in with the principal quantum number, we end up with line width in the few microelectron volt range. I understand that atomic physics people do not like microelectron volt. Therefore, one microelectron volt is 1.5 gigahertz. Yeah, for you, frequencies are much more important. So this is why I have now always this remark here. Roughly, this N2-3 is what is expected for radiative decay, but also for scattering at phonons. As I said in the beginning, we understand by now that it's mostly the coupling to phonons which makes this line width. There is some deviation here, which is still not fully understood. We believe by now that these crystals are not so homogeneous as we thought, so they might have some domain structure, and as soon as the exciton becomes larger than these domains, we feel some inhomogeneity, which leads to this increase. However, if the exciton averages over several of these domains, we see a drop again. But these are details which are more important for semiconductor people. What is interesting is the oscillator strength as a function of N. We see that it also follows an N2-3 dependence, but then we see this quick drop here. And this is, as we believe, the Rydberg blockade, and I will come back to this at the end of my talk. Sure. Oh yeah, sure, because this is the simplest thing that you... I will come back to deviations in a moment. Okay. Then you will see that everything is slightly more complicated. But when you look at this energy scale of a few 10 millielectron volt, it looks like an N2-2 dependence. Okay. But in fact, it's not. Okay. For different reasons than for atoms. Okay, this is already the first deviation from the atom picture. Because when we record that this absorption spectrum with a little bit higher resolution. So we were scanning here again our laser, and you see these strong features here. These are our P-like exciton states, which should be in a simple picture the optically active states. But then we resolved on the high energy flank of these lines. We observed these features, which we first thought, okay, cosmic particles or whatever, but they were reproducible. So when you zoom in here, you start to observe them from n equals 4. And when you zoom in here, you find that these are triplets of lines, and the splitting between these lines becomes smaller as we move to higher principal quantum numbers. Without discussing this in detail, we can describe it also by a quantitative theory, which I want to indicate in a moment. The reason is we are not in vacuum. We are in a crystal. So angular momentum is not a good quantum number. Or speaking it in other terms, angular momentum states become mixed by the crystal. So what happens is that the P excitons become slightly mixed with F excitons, and therefore the F excitons get some oscillator strength from the P excitons. And this is why you can observe them. The line width here is 1 microelectron volt or so pretty narrow. But this is tells you already that you cannot simply describe excitons as hydrogen-like complexes. Yes. In this particular case, it's that the mixing occurs exactly in the even series or in the odd series. And as you observe here, the odd series P excitons are mixed only with the F excitons or with even higher lying excitons. When you go, for example, to n equals 6, you have some indication here which we attribute to H excitons. These are details of the valence band structure that I did not want to discuss in detail, but I will show you the Hamiltonian in a moment, and then you understand why I do not discuss it in detail. What this also tells you is that there is no longer angular momentum degeneracy, of the energies, which you would expect in this simple hydrogen model. And to work this out in more detail, we applied also some electric field. And through application of electric field, we can observe not only the P excitons and the F excitons, but we can sort of mixing with the P excitons. We can also activate the S excitons moving down here. This is a weak feature related to the F excitons. And we can also activate the D excitons here, which you can see here in this contour plot. So there is no longer this orbital angular momentum degeneracy, even though we assume a 1 over r potential. Atomic physics people would describe it by this quantum defect formula with this delta NL here called the quantum defect, which basically was unknown in the semiconductor physics community. So this splitting is lifted, and now I want to explain you why I do not discuss this in detail, because it would be a separate talk. But what is the reason of this splitting? These quantum defects are, of course, known from alkaline atoms. But there, my understanding is that the origin of these quantum defects is the deviation of the Coulomb potential from a 1 over r potential. Yes, the core electrons, and when the outer electron comes close, it feels this deviation from the 1 over r potential. This is not the case for our system. We have a perfect 1 over r potential with dielectric screening. What you have to take into account is the band structure. And our bands are not simply parabolic, but one has to take the deviations from parabolicity into account. So this is the calculated band structure of cuprous oxide using spin density functional theory. So this is not full quantum correlation calculations, but sort of simplified, still gives a rather good description. And what you see here is the calculated band structure of the conduction band. It indeed follows quite well a parabolic dispersion, but the mess starts here in the valence band. And what we did after we had all these numerical results, we fitted these results by a standard Hamiltonian from semiconductor physics, which you might call Luttinger-Cohn Hamiltonian or Hensel-Suzuki Hamiltonian. It's very well known among semiconductor people. This is how you describe the band structure in all cubic crystals, basically. And the dash, or the colored line here, the blue line and the red line, are the fits to the calculated results from basically atomic theory. And if you want to calculate then your exciton, you have to solve this problem, And the hydrogen problem is this part here. And the rest, which looks still sort of not very difficult, but there are a lot of tensors inside and so on, The rest comes all from the valence band structure and makes the problem much more complicated. And it's actually this additional terms which make the problem so complicated and which leads also to the lifting of the orbital angular momentum degeneracy. No, no, no. S exciton would be similarly awful. Yeah.
If you go to larger n, the size grows, right? So
then yes.
Then you stand on the smaller region in k-space. So I would guess the higher an n you go, the less important this.
That's true.
Would become, right?
That's true. When you go to very high n, you find that the splitting becomes smaller and smaller. As you see already here, these F excitons move closer and closer to the P excitons, and they become quasi-degenerate again. That's true. Okay.
Atomic physics is quantum defect does not strongly depend on N. But for you, it depends on N.
It depends on N, yeah, but only for the low-lying N, basically. For higher N, I will show it in a moment, this is basically when you calculate your exciton energies and cast it into this formula for quantum defects, this is basically the result that you get. Oh, here. So you see that there is, for P excitons, we can determine the energy with highest accuracy, and then you find some strong dependence for low lying n, but then it basically levels off to a constant level. Yeah. No, they are also shifted relative to this hydrogen formula, but actually, it also splits slightly up. Yes, yes, but we cannot observe this because the line width is too big. Yeah. No, that's fine. Yeah.
And the second, I mean, you explained that with the quantum effect for the exciton is depending on the delta. So somehow it's depending on the underlying crystal.
Yes.
So this delta should not also depend on the spacing between the I, something related to the crystal instead of from the electron quantum number.
Yes. It's determined by these parameters which appear here in this Hamiltonian, which are really crystal specific. Yeah, but so far I know no other crystal where you can go that high in the exciton series. In that sense, they are so far universal. Okay, so these were two points just to make clear that these are different objects. Yeah, you cannot simply describe them. I should maybe also mention I wanted to do this already here. Are these really excitons or are these polaritons? If you talk to semiconductor people and you consider 3D crystals, you never have an exciton, but you always have a polariton. And polariton, our use of polaritons is a little bit different from the atomic physics people. It's just when you have an exciton and it decays into a photon, this photon in this large crystal is quickly reabsorbed into an exciton and then it decays again into a photon and back. So this is really strong coupling. One normally should take into account this strong coupling, but at least when we do linear spectroscopy, the line width, the damping of this line is larger than the Rabi splitting that we would expect. Therefore, one can describe the energies simply as exciton energies, but we performed, for example, on the ground state, a lot of light propagation studies, and of course, light is slowed down in this crystal due to polariton effects down to a few 10 kilometers per second. So also roughly a factor 10 to the 5 compared to vacuum. But at least for energies, the exciton description is perfect, but in fact, these are polaritons. Yeah.
Since the high-end states have such a huge extension, which are actually larger than that energy or wavelength, larger than the diffraction limit of your microscope, is it possible to map directly by looking at the combination of protons to map the wave function of the exciton?
Should be possible, and it is also on our agenda, but so far we have a homogeneous crystal, and what I said, we excite really polaritons. So see, these are propagating waves which propagate back and forth into our crystal, somewhat similar to the resonator thing that we have heard. I mean, we have here, what do I mean by bulk crystal? This is in effect a crystal which is not a crystal anymore, but a tiny slab with a thickness of 20 or 30 micrometer. So definitely resonator effects will become already important, and this will be also soon studied, because we prepare now a crystal which is sort of tilted so that we can vary the thickness of the crystal and just find out do we have any resonator effects. But I mean, this is next week. Call me in 3 months. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Well, it's just if you describe it correctly, the polariton wave in this crystal is per definition a superposition of an exciton and a photon, similar to the exciton polariton community. Yeah. In their case, the only difference is that they can make the Rabi splitting so large that they can really see two separate states. But in our case, the splitting between these two states is so small that it's sort of hidden below this phonon-induced line width. This is roughly. So I mean, in a bulk crystal, you just cannot avoid strong coupling. It's per definition there, at least if it's ideally infinitely extended. Okay. Then we did also some studies in external electric and magnetic fields, which I don't want to discuss in detail. I just want to highlight why is this sort of fancy or interesting to apply, for example, a magnetic field. Because we have these small Rydberg energy of only 100 millielectron volt, if we apply a magnetic field or electric field, it's easy for us to reach the high field regime. Yeah? Just to give you an example, if you apply a magnetic field, the characteristic energy scale is, of course, the cyclotron energy, which is given by h bar multiplied by the electronic charge times p divided by the mass. And this typically is in the millielectron volt range. So for us, it is rather easy to create cyclotron energies which are larger than the Rydberg energy. While for atoms, you might have to go to 10,000 Tesla or so, for us, it's possible to enter this high field regime easily in the lab by applying just a few Tesla. So we did this, and then this was another reason why we got trapped in some stuff which was not related to interaction effects. This is what we typically observe, yeah? So you see this splitting, which in former times in gallium arsenide could be resolved as a Landau-level-like behavior, but you see here these multiple lines, and the splitting pattern is in effect so complicated that you cannot describe quantitatively anymore, but you apply some statistical methods, and what you then find out is that below n equals 6, you find a regular motion, while above n equals 6, you find what is called quantum chaos. The difference between, simply speaking, between quantum chaos and regular motion is just when you bring two states into resonance and you are in the regular regime, these two states with high probability cross each other. While in the quantum chaos regime, you find basically only anti-crossings. And we spend some time studying this. It's actually a funny quantum chaos that you cannot observe for atoms because all anti-unitary symmetries are broken, again due to this complicated valence band structure. So it's a different quantum chaos than from the atomic physics case. Or we studied also in electric field, and just to give you a simple example what you can do there, this was also not known for simple-minded semiconductor people. Maybe it's known for atomic physics people, or I'm sure that it's known for atomic physics people because it's written in the Gallagher book. So when you look, for example, at the n equals 5 exciton and you apply electric field here, you see here the p exciton, and when you apply the electric field, the p exciton fades away. On the high energy side, you have the f exciton, and the f exciton becomes stronger all the time and survives even longer than the p exciton. And for me, I mean, I teach also quantum mechanics at some point. I could not understand it from first sight because this is clearly a state on the high energy side at higher energies compared to the low energy state. So why should it survive longer than the low energy lines? Everything is written in this Gallagher book. Yeah, what we have is, going back to a simple hydrogen model, we have this 1 over r potential from our exciton. We apply electric field and we tilt just the band structure. And then what I taught students up to now is the higher the energy of the state is in this potential, the easier it is to become dissociated. In this is largely looking at it, this is true, but one has to look also at the wave function. And doing this, for example, for the n equal 3 state, one finds, when one applies an electric field, the splitting into 5 states, which are then superpositions of the zero field states. And here you see the energies, and here you see the corresponding atomic wave functions. And you see that for the lowest energy state, the state is largely moved to the side where the potential barrier is lowered. So this state tunnels more easily through the barrier than the state with highest energy, where the wave function is shifted away from the barrier, which is lowered. So one, it's not only the energy that is important, but it's also the wave function distribution in the potential, which is important. I mean, you are laughing now, but for me, this was not clear, at least. For me, this is satisfying. This is, we typically apply a few volts. Or let's say 80 micron or 70 micron is the space between. So it's kilovolt per centimeter, easy to reach. One has to take care that one does not have any leakage currents, but this is pretty simple. Okay, these are the calculations where one sees this trend. So this is the absorption, n equal 3, 4, 5, 6. If one goes from lower lying n to higher lying n, one indeed sees that the state at higher lying energies dissociate or tunnel at lower voltages, but within a particular multiplet belonging to a particular n, you see that the high energy states survive up to higher voltages, which is exactly related to this wave function distribution. For me, it's just a lead effect, also because I understand it, or I can understand it. Okay, so let me come now to this Rydberg blockade thing, or to these interaction effects, where I have to admit that we are still far behind the atomic physics people. Maybe we will never reach the level that they can sort of realize or obtain in the laboratory. But still, we think that we have also some indications that these interactions might be interesting. So the Rydberg blockade, as I understand it, you have a cloud of atoms here. You use one laser resonantly to excite an atom into one of these Rydberg states. And when you take then basically the same laser and you want to excite an atom which is close to the first atom into a similar Rydberg state or the same Rydberg state, you can no longer do this because due to the strong interaction with the first Rydberg atom here, as shown here by the splitting of this state, resonant absorption is no longer possible. This is the Rydberg blockade as I understand it. We were basically looking for something similar. And the first thing that we noted is when we do not use the lowest possible laser powers in our experiment, as shown here by the blue trace, where we see all these discrete lines, but slightly increase the laser power, then we see already for pretty low laser powers that the higher lying Rydberg exciton lines disappear. This is not a transition into an electron hole plasma, as is known for atomic physics, or from semiconductor physics also, when you pump the crystal really hard and inject a lot of carriers. But this is something else. This can be also seen from the fact that the lines hardly broaden and also the energy does not change a lot. So what we did then is we basically determined the peak area below each peak, just by integrating over each line, as a function of the laser power. And we did it from n equals 12 up to n equals 24. And you see that as you increase the laser power, the lines disappear. First, the higher lying lines disappear. And then for the lower lying lines, you have to apply higher and higher power for the disappearance. In a very primitive model, we were modeling this absorption here by this formula, which gives you the absorption if you could record it with zero laser power, whatever that means, divided by 1 plus the laser power PL times a coefficient Sn, which is just this blockade efficiency. How efficient is a particular state n in blocking the absorption of laser light close by? From the exciton densities that we excited, we could also estimate that if this is a ripback blockade, the ripback blockade volume radius should be roughly also 10 micrometers, very similar to the atomic physics case. So we fitted then the experimental data here with this dependence. I have to admit that the dependence is certainly not perfect, yeah, because determining the area under such a peak is also not so easy, because here you see, for example, again, the phonon-related absorption, which you have to subtract them. So there are error bars. But what you obtain then, naively, is this dependence, which shows this blockade efficiency Sn as a function of the principal quantum number here, shows a pretty smooth dependence, but actually when you go from 12 to 24, it increases by three orders of magnitude. And if you make just a fit by a power law to the data, it scales like the 10th power of n. And yeah, we asked our theory colleagues in Rostock then to model this, and they simply assumed that the blockade efficiency is determined by the product of the blockade volume, just assumed to be a sphere, times the lifetime of an exciton or polariton or whatever, which is just given by the inverse line width. And this critical radius here could be just estimated from the fact that in order to have a blockade, this interaction-induced shift, be it a van der Waals potential or a Förster interaction, should be larger than the line width. Then you get the blockade. And we assumed two different forms, a van der Waal interaction with this R2-6 dependent or a Förster interaction with the R2-3 dependence, with totally different dependence on the principal quantum number. If you plug this all in, you find for both interaction potentials, doesn't matter what the specific form is, you find the N to 10 dependence. Yes? At this point, I would not want to argue quantitatively. So we are still studying this. We also want to find out. For me, these are in a solid state effective potentials. Yeah, R2-6 works, but we are working at the moment heavily, and I will show a few slides on understanding this form in more detail. At the moment, I would say maybe not. Okay, this is just exactly an example that I wanted to give, that we are working at the moment in finding out really what is the exact interaction potential. So this is the current status where we fix the pump laser at n equals 16. So this is here. So this is now a two-color experiment. We pump with the laser fixed at this energy, and then we scan the probe laser across the whole exciton line series. This is the nice thing with this system, because with a single laser, you can scan basically across the whole ripback exciton series because of the small ripback energy. And what you basically find is when you apply here a pump beam with low power, you see that the absorption of the other lines is even slightly enhanced. But when you increase then the pump power here into the hundreds of microwatt regime, that you see that the transmission of all the lines basically is reduced here, which means that all the states go into the blockade regime. Starting from the high energy or high N states here towards the low N state. So you can even push here the N equals 6 state into the blockade regime. And just to give a few details from which we hoped that we can learn something about the interaction potential, if you zoom in here, for example, these are details which I will skip. This is the n equals 6 state. We still pump at n equals 16, and we sort of record the absorption of the n equals 6 state. And you see you have here your 6p states and here the 6f states. And when you look closely for the 6p state, for example, here at this line, you still see some enhancement of the absorption while the F states go already into the blockade regime. So apparently this interaction potential depends strongly on the orbital angular momentum of the state that you are considering. So what we are currently doing is sort of collecting more and more information in order to get really an understanding of the interaction potential and maybe use it for something more interesting than just measuring it. No. Because probably the lifetime is not long enough. Or another thing, if you switch off the absorption at some point, you should induce some absorption at different energies. And this is also what we see. This is a little bit a busy figure, but I have zoomed in here. So this is the line n equals 10. At low pump powers, you see that the absorption is slightly enhanced, and as we increase, then the pump power it goes into the blockade regime. Simultaneously, on the high energy side, we see the reverse behavior. Yeah, here we have first some reduced absorption, while then the absorption is induced, which tells us this should be this shifted interaction energy shifted absorption. And one has to understand that we cannot really control the position of the excitons where we excite them. So we just use a laser beam that big, 3 millimeter, and excite everywhere. So we cannot control the position. Still, this induced absorption here shows reproducibly some fine structure. And what we are currently working on with the guys in Aarhus, they are just calculating the different interaction energies between these states. For example, this is the black lines is the interaction energy between n equals 20 states as we bring them closer together, and you see here some splitting, but these are preliminary results. I cannot comment more, but we have spent a lot of time and recorded tons of spectra in order to get really an understanding of this interaction potential, and I hope that we are close. But what you definitely see is that it seems to be a repulsive interaction, yeah, because this induced absorption develops on the high energy side. Yeah?
Since you if I'm not mistaken, you said that the Rydberg blockade goes like 10 to the power 10.
Yes.
So it should be very, very sensitive to where you put your pump. So
yes.
If you pump, say, then the blue shift should really increase with the N.
Hard to say, because then it depends also what powers can you generate in what exciton densities can you generate in this system. But n to power of 10 holds only for the resonant blockade. We pump at a particular n and we probe at this particular n. If you use a simple van der Waals potential, and I did not discuss it in detail, so you pump at a particular n and you probe at a n prime, use this non-degenerate pump probe. Okay, I'm almost done. I just want to point out one thing, and this is what we also did. We pumped not only at a particular exciton state, but we also, we simply shifted the pump laser across the band gap such that we do not excite any more. We want to understand the influence of this on the exciton absorption. So the question is Rydberg excitons in an electron hole plasma. And again, this is a two-color pump probe experiment, but now the pump laser is shifted across the band gap. The band gap is roughly at this energy, and we shifted it something like 28 millielectron volts above this band gap. Actually, the results do not depend a lot on where you pump when you cross the band gap. But what you observe then is shown here. So we have below the band gap, then if we apply no pump at all, zero pump power, we get this absorption series up to n equals 23 in this particular case. And then we apply a weak pump laser. These are 5 microwatt, but the laser spot was on purpose enlarged in order to find out really weak effects. And you find out that already at this extremely weak pump power, we find that we lose some of these exciton states. Here, for example, 5 milliwatt is still a very low excitation power with these pump spot sizes. The funny thing is that the exciton states below these, where we still observe them, they still have the same energy, and they also show no significant broadening. Yeah, they just stay where they are. So what we believe is that we generate free electron hole pairs, and these free electron hole pairs lead to some chemical potential which reduces the band gap. This is among semiconductor people known as band gap renormalization, but as to my knowledge could not be observed with that accuracy. Actually, we even observe the band gap here, because you see that the absorption here, which is a Urbach tale, but this is not important here. I said that the absorption above the band gap becomes basically a constant, and this is exactly what we observe here at this point. When we apply no pump power, we see that the absorption becomes constant, and already this energy is below the band gap that you would nominally expect. And probably this is because we have in our crystal unavoidable free charges, which lead already to a band gap renormalization. What this means is that when you look exactly, it does not even make sense to talk about a band gap in a semiconductor, because it depends very much on what is your free carrier density in this crystal, and this will shift your band gap by even one millielectron volt. Yeah. So for cuprous oxide, you find variations in the band gap by a few millielectron volt, and we believe that this is related to this free carrier density, which you can map out now in this extremely sensitive experiment. And as you increase then an increasing, or as you generate then an increasing number of electron hole pairs, you see that this band gap, this is where the absorption becomes constant, continuously shifts. The energy scale is below one millielectron volt to lower energies because of the increase of the chemical potential. But what is still funny, the energies of the excitons stay constant. This is also an effect that was known among semiconductor people in former times, but they could study only the 1s exciton. And one observes the band gap renormalization, but the exciton roughly stays constant because the reduction of the band gap is compensated by a screening of the Coulomb potential. And these two effects and screening roughly compensate each other. What was totally surprising for us and totally striking, that it seems to be an almost perfect compensation. Yeah, the exciton lines here do not move at all. Oh, they do, yeah, and this is something which we cannot say exactly what they do. But if they recombine by LO phonons, they quickly form 1s excitons, and we believe that these are unexcited excitons, which are much smaller than these excitons and do not interact strongly. But this is something which we cannot control.
Yeah. Can you do by two photon absorption, can you create the dark state which cannot recombine radiatively and then have a long-lived window state?
Well, actually, when you go with your laser above the band gap in single photon absorption, you generate a dark state because this is a forbidden transition, which is of course modified by Coulomb interactions. Yeah, it's a bit more complicated because then an higher lying exciton series sets in, which are the green excitons. So this is something which we just cannot perfectly control, as perfect as in atoms. Yeah.
No, but my question is, if you come with a two photon.
Yeah.
Into a Rydberg state,
yes,
which is one of your states, but it's dark, it doesn't couple light. Then you can do all the Coulomb blockade stories, everything, but with long lived, right? Rydberg state.
In principle, yes, but in fact, not. Because already at these energies, the green exciton series sets in, and green exciton series is electric dipole allowed. So this mixes then with the yellow exciton series, and then everything becomes much more complicated, unfortunately. So this is the price we pay because we have this damped semiconductor band structure. So this was also our idea. Still, two-photon absorption is nice. You can nicely see the importance of polaritonic effects and all that stuff in two-photon absorption, and we did it. Yeah, but it I would say, yeah. Just a final thing is, what is still surprising is we can switch off this Rydberg exciton absorption at these laser powers, but then you can convert it into a plasma density. How many electron hole pairs do you have in fact? And then you see that the highest exciton states disappear already for a plasma density of 0.01 electron hole pairs per cubic micrometer. So already 0.01 electron hole pairs within such a Rydberg exciton is sufficient to switch it off. This was at least for me surprising. So it's sort of a control of absorption of Rydberg excitons by fractional charge. Already 1/100th of an electron hole pair is sufficient to switch it off. I mean, we have worked out this a little bit, but this might not be so important. I better come to the conclusion. So maybe just to compare the two systems, Rydberg excitons versus Rydberg atoms. I think our advantages are that we can really scan many different states n by a single laser. So it's easy for us to develop a systematic picture. We can also, if we apply it to external field, easily reach the high field regime. We have, on the other hand, significant disadvantages. For example, we have this complex valence band structure, which we just cannot get rid of. And we have also these manifold interactions that we can also not avoid, for example, coupling to phonons, coupling to photons, and they become on this extreme high resolution energy scale just important. What we are currently doing, or what we are thinking about doing, we have these higher angular momentum states, and there is already for quite some time this orbital angular momentum light around. And in order to use it for some spectroscopy, the object which you want to excite has to have the same size and the light wavelength. So this light might be ideally suited to generate high angular momentum excitons states. We also turn to the time-resolved regime, want to demonstrate Rabi oscillations. You want to understand the Rydberg blockade better. And what is also nice, you can easily generate potential landscapes in this material and sort of perform some, fancy speaking, quantum simulator stuff. And there you have different possibilities. For example, you can apply a strained potential landscape to a crystal. One could also use optical lattices, a P is missing here, or use some illumination by a spatial light modulator just to imprint different exciton densities and thereby study interaction effects. So this is on our agenda for the next years to come, and that's all I wanted to say. Thanks.